less than a month, my mother and my mother-in-law are gonna be moving out to Portland, where they will live with me and my wife for the rest of their lives. This wasn't my idea. But I do take responsibility for going along with it. It felt right. Felt fine, most of the time. When it doesn't feel right, every time it's because there's a voice in my head that says, "Are you sure?" There isn't a lifestyle, a life trajectory that isn't so much better than this that's out there somewhere. It's a voice that I've had in my head for as long as I can remember. When I was growing up, I was in a household where, now looking back on it, based on how I felt and what occurred later, love between my parents and most of the family members was gone. Both my parents are extremely lovable people. And like anybody, I think they really sought to feel better about themselves and to have a relationship help out with that. They were matched as such so that I think they were only really capable of helping each other feel worse about themselves. And I believe that by the time I came along, the scheme was the jig was up. And but it took them about 13 more years to figure that out and to really have it confirmed beyond a reasonable doubt. This was not a comfortable situation to be in. There was no verbal abuse that I think would hold up in court. There was no physical abuse. But beneath a surface of rigor and quirkiness and cheer was this kind of vibe like a stagnant swamp. Just a hot, itchy, ugh, kind of yuck. And I think that a person would go insane if they, without any other options for escape or any other options for how to influence the situation, if they stayed in that. And a voice came into my head that said, "Are you sure there's nothing better than this out there for you?" And that voice suddenly gave me a whole new option to get out of this day-to-day muck and mire that somehow was inside, and an opportunity to go up onto a plane. And I'm not talking about a jet plane, I'm talking about a parallel plane of those that, what? Well, what, how do you get there? Who gets there? How do you get out? When I was 5, I won the first of what would be many art contests when I was a kid. And at the same time, my father was reading me these wonderful books where I was shown that the adults could win art awards themselves, like the Caldecott Medal and the Caldecott Honor, those wonderful Chris von Allsburg books. I also learned as a precocious young writer that there were people in adulthood who could earn writing awards. And you know, this started with recognizing the Newbery Honor and the Newbery Medal, and of course later the Pulitzer Prize, the Nobel Prize. Oh my God, oh my God, oh my God, yes, 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 I'm starting to get it. My father instilled a love of movies in me, and I saw that these movies could get 4-star reviews and a love for rock and roll. And they, you could, if you were the best, you could get a 5-star album and maybe make a lot of money. And I saw that I had this potential. And the voice saying, "Are you sure there isn't something better out there?" Yes, I'm sure that there is something better out there. I'm going to claim it. I'm going to work, and I'm going to claim it. And I'm going to go up onto the plane, and I will never have to come down. I can condescend to visit every now and again, but never. the hero's return, but just for publicity. And then, back up. And on that plane, it is clean, it is clear, and it is beautiful, and you are always feeling contentment and love, no matter what shit goes down here. And so, boy, I was on the way. Junior high, won poetry contest. High school, advanced art classes. Freshman year, English professor told me that he hadn't seen essays like this since he was teaching college. Senior year, won an award for a one-act play that I compiled and put together and organized. Won acting awards freshman year of high school and college recommendation from a second teacher my sophomore year who was known as a real hard ass, said that Matt Haynes is as close to a genius as anybody I've ever worked with. And I went to college riding on that and graduated summa cum fucking laude.
Yeah!
Well, that, boy, not very enthusiastic. Well, okay, that's the point. Well, I was on my way, though. I was on my way to the higher plane, and it was time for adulthood to begin. And with all this potential, one would think that at the prime of adulthood, age 35 or so, you know, still young, getting older, that, you know, I would be accepting my Oscar for a lead role in a film based on my Nobel Prize-winning play cycle, which had been produced all over the world and thus had earned me my first billion. Well, I turned 35 last month. I don't have the title of an Oscar winner. I have the title of a half-time daycare provider. I have not earned my first billion, but I do earn minimum wage for that daycare job. I have a theater company. It is not completely demolished canned entertainment and made the world suddenly wake up to the joys of live theater, but we do have a reading once a month of somebody else's play on a digital tablet in a bar. And, you know, very soon I'll be living with my mother again. So the term loser doesn't come into mind very often until the voice, my mentor, comes back and says, "Are you sure that there isn't something so much better for you out there because you're getting further and further away from it? What the fuck are you doing with yourself?" Well, what had I been doing? What's interesting, by the way, this voice hurts like hell. And when listening to it, it grinds like dissonant music up against whatever I happen to be doing in my life. But actually, when the voice is either ignored or I'm distracted from it, everything that I'm doing makes perfect sense. It feels right, and then looking back on it, yeah, it's great. Daycare provider, well, guess what? Solid hours. My morning is occupied and invigorating. I have the afternoon to myself, 5 days a week. Beautiful. And I work with some of the most invigorating and hilarious individuals that anybody will get to work with. And I get to practice on a moment-to-moment basis being loving and patient with them. And in terms of the theater project, well, you know, I it was my idea to do the tablets thing and my idea to take it to a bar. I'm interested in exploring the primary force of storytelling and getting back to that and really having a chance to dig into that. And I'm free to do that now and still have an opportunity to sleep 8 hours a night. And the mom's moving out. I don't know why that's a good thing. At least in terms of plan, but it feels good. When we had a test stay in Portland for a month last year, ironically, I never felt more grown up and settled and free. Then when after a day's work and my personal ups and downs, I went home to my family. And I think I am learning to accept that when I became an adult and could make my own choices and take responsibility for how I dealt with situations and how I thought about situations, that I actually made brilliant choices. And I just made choices that felt good. And those choices led to other choices that felt really good. And so 1 month from now, it's gonna happen again based on a choice that I made and that I take responsibility for. And the voice, when it comes back and says, "Are you sure there isn't something better out there?" I know that that voice, which maybe once saved my life, is now blocking it. And I can answer that voice with full confidence. Yes, I'm sure there's something better. It's called my current life. And I hope to claim it very soon.